Welcome to the Communitarian Project podcast. Today's episode is going to be about Pierre-Joseph Proudhon, who lived between 1809 and 1865. This podcast is going to be my own personal exploration into his ideas. Hopefully it will be useful to you. For in-depth notes, please visit Communitarian Project website, see link below. I was first introduced to Proudhon when I read a biography written by George Woodcock. And after finishing that book, I kind of had the opinion that his position was inconsolable to my own. However, I went on to read a book which was a selection of writings from Proudhon himself, after which I was pleasantly surprised to discover that his political philosophy was much closer aligned to my own than I was expecting. Also, I was extremely impressed by some of the originality of his ideas. My initial impression was that his emphasis on mutual exchange was too cold and uninspiring. Even though I have not completely abandoned this analysis, it is clear that his ideas are not as straightforward as I first thought. Let's begin analysing his ideas. Firstly, a significant proportion of his ideas are concerned with challenging the conventional view of economics. He does this with an almost surgical precision, dissecting economic concepts that we take for granted. The first of these is that capital is unproductive. Now, I have a hunch that this idea is not original with him. However, this is my first introduction to it. He states, quote, that man is freely provided with the raw materials by nature, that is, therefore, in the economic order, all products are the result of labour, and all capital is unproductive. I found this provocative and true in equal measures. Put simply, labour is the only thing produces any products or services. Capital by itself cannot produce or create anything. An inanimate pile of money is by itself unproductive. Instead, capital allows for the productivity of others to be stolen from them. In other words, the exploitation of the working class. Now, there is an obvious critique to such an argument that capital is actually a means of providing investment, therefore facilitating production. However, Proudhon's attack is not directed at those who would work in financial industries who invest capital, because he would probably classify this as a type of work. He's directing his critique at those who do nothing but profit from the productivity of others. There is a subtle but important distinction. This is a theme which is brought up later on in his thought. His next observation is a critique around the division of labour. Proudhon highlights the problematic implications resulting from the division of labour. As a definition, the division of labour is the dividing of production away from one job role into a subdivision of many. He explains that such a division leads to labour being thought about on an isolated basis. As a result, this ignores any collaborative basis for understanding labour. He identifies two ways it is ignored. Firstly, the division of labour ignores collaborative labour. The open labour market dictates that each individual is paid a sum for their proportion of labour. From first appearances, this seems necessary. However, Proudhon identifies a serious flaw with such an economic logic. He identifies that when a group works together, the sum total production slash value they create is greater than if they were to work in isolation. Put another way, the production slash value created with a workforce of 100 working for one day would be greater than one working for 100 days. Of course, he recognizes that this only applies to jobs that require collaborative effort. Nevertheless, there are many jobs which require individuals to work side by side with one another to achieve a shared goal. The thrust of his attack is that capitalists are not justified in paying individuals on an isolated basis, since they are excessively profiting from the true value of the collective labour. His second critique of the division of labour is how it ignores, in general, the collaborative force of labour. In a much broader sense, he criticises the ignorance of collaborative force when understanding the political economy as a whole. He makes an obvious point which is easy to forget. Although the economy may appear to be a collection of individuals pursuing their own destiny, it is better understood as an interconnected network of job roles. It follows that if society is to function, these job roles need to be filled. This may seem like an obvious dead-end point, but Proudhon identified some significant ramifications. There is a common assumption that a particular job role reflects a person's capacity. However, if society is to function, certain undesirable jobs need to be filled, and this may have no bearing on a person's capacity. Put crudely, if individuals do not toil in the sewer, then the city will become plagued with disease. Even when a job role does reflect a difference in a person's capacity, this does not justify a huge disparity in wages. Put another way, to pay one man 10 times that of another cannot accurately reflect a greater intelligence or strength. The final critique of conventional economics is his most famous, and that is critique of property. Now, as a young man, Proudhon won a scholarship which gave him national recognition. Within this piece of work, he coined the phrase, property is theft. From its very conception, this essay was widely misunderstood, and Proudhon spent much of his formative years explaining what he exactly meant. His critique of property was influenced by Rousseau's ideas on the origin of inequality. Quote, Rousseau, "The first man who, having enclosed a piece of ground, bethought himself of saying, 'This is mine,' and found people simple enough to believe him, was the real founder of civil society. From how many crimes, wars, and murders, from how many horrors and misfortunes might not anyone have saved mankind by pulling up the stakes or filling up the ditch and crying to his fellows, 'Beware of listening to this impostor. You are undone if you once forget that the fruits of the earth belong to us all, and the earth itself to no one.'" Proudhon begins by making the proposition that everyone has a justified claim to the value of their own labour. Yet again, there seems nothing controversial about this point. On one hand, a person's productivity is their own. If this was not the case, then they would be enslaved. But crucially, on the other hand, a person is not justified to claim the productivity of others, since this would be theft. From this proposition is where his attack of property originates. It follows that if a property owner claims to have ownership over natural resources, then this is inconsistent with Proudhon's proposition, since the value created from the fruits of the earth cannot be attributed to any individual's capacity. For example, a landowner cannot facilitate the forming of granite. According to this logic, everyone has an equal claim to natural resources. To charge another for access to natural resources is, according to Proudhon, theft, since that person is unjustly stealing the productivity of others. Such an argument is indisputable, especially when considering it in the context of serfs and lords. Imagine an owner of a large estate who lives an almost idle existence while claiming the productivity of peasants who work on his land. It is the peasants who labour hard on the land, but it is the landlord who siphons the productivity from them, even though it is the land itself which is the real producer. His critique of property yet again demonstrates Proudhon's radical but yet rational thought. As mentioned earlier, there has been significant confusion around his message. Some have confused his statement that property is theft to be an advocation of the abolishment of private property in general. In fact, he believed that property ownership is the key cornerstone of any free society. However, can property both be liberty and theft? To answer this, we need to move away from his critique of economics to his ideas concerning politics. Property as liberty. Proudhon argues that property is the most powerful political force which can defend liberty. He believes that the French revolutionary history can be explained by it, by proclaiming that it is, quote, the greatest existing revolutionary force. If this powerful force centralizes in the hands of a small class of property owners, then it loses its revolutionary capacity. But most of all, he feared that such an elite would seamlessly liaise with the power of the state. The only way to counterbalance this situation is for universal property ownership, free from external conditions, and free access to raw materials. Of course, such a vision is extremely radical and implausible, but his claim was that with such an economic power, individuals would be able to challenge any infringement on their liberty. In reading his ideas, it is strikingly obvious how the importance of property is often played down in our society. Instead, property is only seen as an asset instead of a principle of liberty. As in, an individual is not truly free until they are a controller of their own production. Therefore, Proudhon believes there is an almost contradictory nature to property. What makes Proudhon's views around conventional economics so unusual is that he takes seriously the connection between economics and justice. So to understand how property can be both immoral and a civic ideal, one must understand justice. Quote, I put forward the idea of making property morally acceptable by making justice an integral part of it, without there being any adverse effects on the economic consequences. At the heart of his ideas around property is an outright rejection of powerful hierarchies, in particular the state itself. This leads us to discuss his political ideas in greater depth. Proudhon's criticisms of the state. He makes some general attacks about the inevitable practical implications of such a powerful institution. Many of such attacks are not particularly inventive or inspiring. However, I have cherry-picked some of the most convincing. A strong theme throughout his work is that the individual should have precedence over all social, economic, and political domains. For this same reason, Proudhon recognizes that representative democracy is a clear advancement away from authoritarian regimes. However, representative democracy still have authoritarian faculties without which the system may collapse. For instance, punish of those who do not pay tax. Proudhon makes a simple but striking point that human history has progressed away from authoritarianism. But isn't self-governance the greatest expression of this journey? He therefore considers representative democracy as a stepping stone towards an alternative future. His critique is based on the state's infringement of liberties as a practical necessity. However, as far more profound critique is that the state is not justified to exercise such authority. He makes the bold but true claim that, quote, justice is an essential characteristic of man. As a consequence, the existence of justice can never depend or be attributed to some sort of external authority. Of course, this critiques religious belief. However, it also critiques the idea that justice is a phenomena cultivated by hierarchical political structures. The idea that legislation is somehow a prerequisite for the concept of justice is clearly false. For instance, it is clear that morality precedes the creation of any courts. Such an understanding of justice has profound consequences for how one should consider the role of the individual. It is the individual, not any external authority, which should be the arbiter of justice. If true, the state does not have any legitimate reason to exercise its authority. State authority is based on the assumption that citizens need a certain amount of restriction or cultivation to stop them descending into barbarism. Such a position is a well-established anarchist principle. Interestingly, Proudhon's critique of the state has been adopted by left and right-wing thinkers. However, in reality, he is neither. After considering his attack upon the state, it is easy to see how his thought has been adopted by the right. However, it would be wrong to co-opt his thought into claiming he was in favour of shrinking state power in place of free market capitalism. In a similar vein, it is wrong to suggest that he is a state socialist, since he does not support the idea that it is through the state intervention that the distribution of justice can be achieved, or that individuals are able to reach the pinnacle of their liberty. Interestingly, in regards to communism, Proudhon had some correspondence with Karl Marx, and he directly warned him against dogmatic thinking. Quote, "Let us not set ourselves up as the apostles of a new religion, even if it is the religion of logic or of reason." Proudhon's point was that even if a communist state has the most just reasons for its existence, it doesn't mean that it is justified to use its authority. Eventually, this standoff relationship deteriorated even further when Proudhon eventually described Marx as, quote, "the tapeworm of socialism." The principal reason why Proudhon isn't left or right-wing is because he is a political anarchist. In fact, he is well known for being the first self-proclaimed anarchist. He was well aware of the connections between the word anarchy and that of chaos. He makes clear that anarchism is primarily the absence of rulers and not the absence of principles or laws. He states that, quote, "Just as man seeks justice in equality, society seeks order in anarchy." To expand this point, it is true that authoritarian hierarchies do provide order. Such order is not driven by society itself, but only by hierarchies themselves. If the ideal society is to be fully realized, all individuals would have to participate in its construction without the need for the existence of any leader. I believe this is what is meant by, quote, "society seeks order in anarchy." To clarify, he is not arguing that each individual should be an independent sovereign. Instead, society should be organized and ordered as the relation between equal partners. Anarchism provides an alternative to the left and the right-wing ideologies. Since both require the hierarchy of the state, anarchism does not. How would anarchism be achieved? It is very important to note that the first person to identify as an anarchist did not support violent revolution. He simply did not believe that a single event could produce any significant change. His point is pragmatic. For instance, he had the privileged position of experiencing the French Revolution of 1848. He claims that it failed since it did not bring about a different economic system. As he puts it, quote, "The real problem to be solved is not a political one, it is an economic one." If the economic factor is not addressed, then he foresaw a continuing conflict between the classes. However, what about a violent revolution, which can bring about a new economic paradigm? Interestingly, he would still oppose such calls for revolution, for if a single violent event brought about a new economic system, it is certain that certain individuals would be forced to comply. Instead, a revolution must be gradually developed and agreed upon by the masses themselves. He therefore concludes that any party/government-led revolution would be a contradiction in terms. Therefore, he would only support revolution in a slow, measured, rational sense. Therefore, what does Proudhon advocate? To truly understand how Proudhon thought anarchism would be achieved, one has to understand his whole political philosophy. Put simply, he advocated that the law of exchange should replace the state apparatus. Quote, "Instead of asking the capitalist for credit and the state for protection, it will make both capital and the state subordinate to labour. Through the genuine nature of exchange, it will create true solidarity between people." What he means by genuine nature of exchange is what he called mutualism. Mutualism is simply the exchanging of goods and services for mutual benefit. To facilitate this mutual exchange, he envisioned and tried to set up in his lifetime what he called the People's Bank. The first thing to understand about the operation of such a bank is Proudhon's radical desire to return to a direct exchange between people. Instead of selling for tender, the bank would facilitate the direct exchange of goods with no need for conventional currency. For instance, one party needs eggs, another needs bread. The two exchange on a ratio to which they can agree. It stands to reason that the value of such goods would not be based on an open market model, but rather on an individual case basis. He believes that this would create a fairer, genuine nature of exchange, since members would only exchange with other members, guaranteeing they give a fair exchange for each other's labour. This is quite different from how a capitalist system works. Within a capitalist system, exchange is an impartial mechanism. In contrast to mutualism, which has an almost intimate nature, another important difference is that it requires everyone to be a producer. Put another way, it is a web of exchanges between self-employed individuals. In principle, it doesn't allow individuals to sell the productivity of others or to live off capital without labouring. Such an idea provides a solution to the injustices he identified with capitalism. How does the People's Bank facilitate these direct exchanges? Proudhon argues that the only way to facilitate this mutual trade is through what he called the People's Bank. I must state that I'm not entirely clear on the full details of how such a bank would operate. Here's my best attempt. The bank would have its own currency known as circulating vouchers. These would be produced to represent all the direct exchanges which are to take place. It would be based not on products which are to be manufactured, but only on those that are going to be exchanged. In theory, the currency would not need to be backed by anything. It is largely based on faith that when trading in a direct fashion, individuals would not act unjustly to one another. The bank keeps records of all the members and exchanges. He believes that this bank would facilitate free trade and competition amongst its members, who are all independent agents. An interesting point is that he's essentially arguing for a large centralized bank. On the face of it, this seems almost anti-anarchist proposition, since it is advocating for a large institution. However, its main purpose is to facilitate the interaction between individual parties. Therefore, I do not think it could be defined as a hierarchical institution. Proudhon makes the point that liberty by itself is not a satisfactory goal. Instead, human beings require truth, mutualism, and law. Overall, it is a very bold and unusual vision of how anarchism could work in practice. It is important to recognize that he is advocating for something and not just destruction of existing institutions. Even though it advocates for the return of a primitive form of exchange, it nevertheless provides an alternative vision to capitalism and the pitfalls of communism. Personally, even though I value the principle of reciprocity, there is something slightly hollow in the idea that individuals only exchange for personal gain. Instead, I believe the underpinnings of any society should be based on a moral obligation and not reciprocity. To complicate matters, mutualism is not the end of Proudhon's thought, and he does advocate for something beyond mutual exchange. As a result, there is a significant tension within his work between the individual and the communal. I will try to give a fuller explanation. Individualism and self-interest. Proudhon is a passionate advocate of personal liberty and is gravely concerned with any situation which conflicts with an individual's freedom. As already stated, this is why he is considered an anarchist thinker. He believes that this liberty can only be truly ascended through mutualism. How does this web of mutual agreements differ from a citizen's relationship to the state? The simple answer being, he believes that mutualism would encourage virtuous behaviour. The current system does not require individuals to be virtuous. It instead encourages them to be solely self-interested. Let's consider his condemnation of self-interest further. For instance, quote, "Nothing is of any account except owning property and owning enough of it, whatever the means by which it was acquired. As he sees it, what was worth beginning is worth continuing. His sole aim is to increase the amount of property he owns by all the questionable means by which he got it in the first place. He exploits the poor, heckles with the labourer over his wages, pillages and pilfers on all sides, here appropriating a furrow from his neighbour's field, and there moving the boundary stone when he is sure that he will not be seen. I have even seen one man in a boundary ditch scraping up the earth with his bare hands and throwing it to his side, and looking as if he were eating it and enjoying it. He makes it his business to extract the maximum from his savings and interests. There is no harsher usher, no worse employer, no one slower to pay his bills. On top of all this, he is a hypocrite and a coward, afraid of the devil and of the law, fearing the penalty rather than opinion. Judging others by his own standard, he sees them all as rogues. He is completely indifferent to public affairs and never becomes involved in politics except to get those taxes reduced or to sell his vote, while he rejoices in the electoral incorruptibility of his far-sighted fellow citizens that allow him to turn his own vote to an advantage. Such is the property owner, as seen literally and through the eyes of principle, all through these materialism and egoism, which is another way of saying the same thing. What Proudhon is identifying in this passage is a selfish individualism. He rightly argues that such a notion has led to moral corruption. He warns that if such economic progress continues, so too will moral corruption to an unpredictable level. The condition of our society today lays testament to this. However, there is a tension. While he supports property ownership, he denounces self-interested behaviour brought about by property ownership. To understand why, we have to dissect the connection he makes between economics and justice. In general, it is agreed that there are some ties between economics and justice. Proudhon instead makes a rather more dogmatic point. He argues that we should only understand them as two inherently connected forces. He argues that only by understanding them in these terms are we, as human beings, are able to reach our full potential and thereby establish a social equilibrium. It would be a mistake to assume that he is in agreement with the left in general. The idea that individuals can only reach their full potential in an egalitarian society, but in the same token, he doesn't support the right's claim that an inequality in the economy is a necessary feature. Instead, Proudhon, whom was heavily influenced by Hegel, believed that there should be a synthesis between these two opposing views of economic justice. Let's go back and unpack his alternative. Quote, "We, as human beings, are able to reach our full potential and thereby establish a social equilibrium." He supports, on one hand, the inequality in human capacity, and on the other, social justice. What he's advocating is that if individuals are to truly reach their highest potential, they will naturally consider social good as a worthy ideal. Therefore, in reality, individuals should have the freedom to secure their own economic destiny. Thereby, they will be in a position to understand their moral duty. Quote, "Only when man has become reconciled with himself and ceases to regard his neighbour and nature as hostile forces, will he be able to love and to create through the force of his spontaneity alone. Then he will desire to give, whereas today he desires only to acquire. and it will be in labour and devotion that he seeks the whole happiness and supreme pleasure. When this happens, when love becomes the true and only law governing mankind, justice will become a meaningless word, an unwelcome memory from an era of violence and tears. Therefore, his mutual exchange does develop into advocating a type of social morality. He supports a Darwinian explanation for why we have a psychological awareness of our own dignity and that of others. His collective moral consciousness is, according to him, an essence of society itself. As a result, he has a rather loose definition of justice. As he explains, it could be both subjective and objective. This escapes the dogma typically surrounding ethical debates, which is refreshing. In a practical sense, he saw physical labour as key to a social equilibrium. In fact, he wished it would be considered as divine as any religion. He envisioned this would happen if work was based around community and solidarity. Everyone would toil for the sake of others. Such a lifestyle could only function if the interests of the individual are identical to that of the community. Even though it seems old-fashioned, I completely agree with his ideas of the importance of physical labour. To conclude, why as a communitarian am I interested in Pierre-Joseph Proudhon's political writings? Firstly, his critique of conventional economics seems pretty sound, since it is hard to dispute that the fruits of the earth do not belong to everyone, and that these ideas are very compatible with communitarian ethos. And also, he recognises the problem with selfish individualism, which is the main adversary of communitarian thinking. However, in regards to his solution, the idea that the genuine nature of exchange will create true solidarity between people on the basis of mutual trade, I'm not so convinced. I don't know why this wouldn't just lead to more selfish behaviour. However, he is convinced that once people are on this footing, they will have more of a moral outlook. However, as a communitarian, there really needs to be an explicit moral philosophy which promotes virtue. Anyway, thanks for listening. If you've got any questions, please put them below, and hopefully I'll carry on doing these with other thinkers. Thanks. Bye.